background noise.
We are live on Facebook and I welcome all to the third webinar conducted by Mumbai Network of English Teachers and convener is Renu Dhotrayan. So it's over to you, Renu ma'am.
Welcome everybody. Good evening everyone and thank you dear participants for your presence. Your constant support energizes us to continue the good work of supporting each other and bringing different communities together. I welcome the participant and the speaker for this midweek webinar series organized by MNET. As I always say, MNET has been founded by a group of like-minded English teachers to support fellow teachers to deal with classroom problems, introduce new and innovative technologies in the teaching learning process, assist them in undertaking classroom research, and to highlight innovative ideas and achievements of English teachers and offer them a platform to showcase their talents. In short, it's aimed at expanding the learning horizons of English teachers, adding to their continuous professional development and productively impacting their students. Now, teachers, the present moment of crisis has necessitated teachers of all disciplines to embrace technology as their platform. The classroom setup is now replaced by the digital screen. And the blackboard is now a transparent screen with visuals appears and disappears. The assignments and assessment has transformed into digital submissions. It is a sink or swim situation where teachers have to explore technological sources to make their online classes more engaging. However, for the teacher fraternity, who have almost used face-to-face interaction and practice as a primary mode of classroom transactions, becoming an online teacher comes with a set of challenges. Even if one masters and overcomes the challenge of technology and navigates successfully through various LMS and quiz platforms, one key thread that remains is the question of maintaining interactivity in the online space. This webinar inquires into this subject and attempts to offer pragmatic solutions which can address the issue by surveying and studying major best practices adopted real-time. The webinar presents tried and tested strategies to enhance learners' engagement in the online classroom. And to present this, we have with us Dr. Shobha K.N. She's a teacher, researcher and a teacher educator, currently working as assistant professor of English at Anna University, Chennai. An avid learner interested in investigating ways to approach and handle classroom issues in teaching the English language. She has a PhD in English funded by the University Grant Commission NET Senior Research Fellowship, a master's in education, gold medalist and TESOL US certification in teaching English. Dr. Shobha has authored textbooks and workbooks with Cambridge University Press and Orient Black Swan for learners of the English language at the tertiary level. In addition to several research articles, she has been a member of the content development team of the Content and Language Integrated Learning Textbook for the Tamil Nadu Textbook Corporation of Arts and Science College and the ITI textbook on employability skills for the National Instructional Media Institute, Ministry of Skill Development and Entrepreneurship. Shobha is also a trainer cum consultant for the Research Connect program of the British Council. She is the chief consultant and resource person for the State Council of Education, Research and Training for the state of Andhra Pradesh and has developed textbook at the primary level. She's also of the strong conviction that the 21st century skill of communication, critical thinking, creativity and collaboration are vital to both learners and teachers of the English language because English opens door. So welcome, ma'am. We are very happy to have you amongst us. Over to Dr. Shobha.
Thank you so much. Renu, that was a wonderful introduction. Thank you for the very kind words. I'm really happy to be here. when Renu called me and asked whether I could do a webinar for teachers, English teachers from Mumbai, I was very excited. Because yes, as university professors, we are very busy with so many things to juggle. But then we always know that a call from a friend, from a good friend, related to empowering teachers, is always a yes. So I'm very happy to be here, and I'm very glad to share my, a little expertise that I have on this area, because due to the present crisis, like Renu pointed out, it is definitely a sink or swim situation, because without any kind of training, previous knowledge, all of us have suddenly been asked to become online teachers. So there is no choice here. Nobody asked us whether we would like to teach online or whether we would like to, download all these tools and use it for our classrooms. All of a sudden, we are now teaching online, and I'm also delivering a lot of webinars online. So a couple of housekeeping rules before we start off. It would be very nice if you can just mute yourself so that we don't have background noise. And number two, if you can turn your video off, the bandwidth will be also okay, and we can have a very smooth delivery of the presentation. The presentation will go on for 40 to 45 minutes. And if you have any questions or queries, I request all the participants to put it in the chat box so that at the end of the session, I would open the chat box and I will be more than happy to answer some of the questions that you have asked. So going to the presentation itself, strategies for delivering engaging and interactive online sessions. Our strength as language teachers lies on the way we interact with our learners. Whether you're a school teacher or a college professor or a university professor, students only remember how we interact with them in the classroom. And I always used to say that classroom is the fort for a teacher, and all our forte lies in how we handle the classroom. All of us, with time, with experience, we have become masters of classroom management. We know how to make it very engaging. We know how to handle a lot of multimedia inside the classroom for learners. However, when it comes to the online sphere, sometimes we are not very comfortable using the tools themselves, right? We want to use Zoom, we want to use Google Meet or Cisco WebEx. There are so many video conferencing platforms that we want to use. Apart from this, how to use the Google platform or the Zoom platform and how to make teaching happen? That is the most important question. Learning to use these tools is one thing, but using them very effectively for teaching learning to happen is totally another. We are moving away from teacher-centered classrooms to learner-centered classrooms. We are actually in learning-centered classrooms. And believe me, this learning is not only for the student, but also for the teacher. When I'm saying that we are all in learning-centered classrooms, I mean that the learning is both for the student and for the teacher. And especially on the online platform, it becomes very important for us to engage our student, because most of the time we put all our heart and soul and prepare so many learning resources, but we never know if the learner is also interested, whether the learner is simply posting a picture on the platform and whether he is going and sleeping or whether he is actually listening to our lectures. We don't know. That's why it is very important to find out our sessions very interactive. So the table of contents is going to look like this. We are going to look at only four aspects of the content. The first one, I would start with a brief overview, the emergence of the online teacher, how suddenly we have emerged into the scene without any degrees or certifications. All of us are using the online platforms. The second one would try and focus on how to make content design and delivery very engaging. Of course, these are the three important aspects when it comes to making our online sessions very engaging. And the third section, I would be talking about how to make it interactive. So though we are preparing very interesting content, though we are preparing, designing our lessons very interestingly, How are we going to make it very interactive? Because whatever TLMs we are using in the classroom, when it comes to online, there are certain challenges, there are certain pros and cons to those TLMs. So what are the tools in the online platform that we can exploit to the maximum? And the final section would look at some takeaways for teachers, you know, how we can try and upscale the teaching learning process. So I hope the table of contents is very clear. We are only going to look at four aspects. Number one is overview, the emergence of the online teacher. Number two will be how to make it very engaging. And the third one is going to be what are the tools and techniques and strategies for being very interactive online, and what are going to be the takeaways. Moving on. So I hope that most of you would have come across this particular, quotation of Bill Gates. So Bill Gates has said that technology is just a tool, right? This is only a tool. In terms of getting the learning, of motivating, is always the teacher. You know, the teacher who is going to work, the teacher who is going to lead the classroom. That is why, now say for example, if you want to solve the problem of reading. Now, some child has a problem with reading. What is the tool that you will be using? A textbook or a storybook? You know, you would be using that kind of a tool. Do you think the textbook itself will teach the child? No. Still, the teacher has to sit next to the child and the teacher has to help out. Now, say for example, if you want to help your children with some pronunciation practice, what will we do? We will get the audio recordings, we will get the tape recorder or the mobile phone, and we will play it. And we will show it to the student. We will make the children listen to the audio practice. So the tape recorder or the textbook is only a tool. The teacher has to be present there, right? So many of us misunderstand that when you're using technology, technology will take care. If you're using Google Classroom, if you put all your students inside Google Classroom, we assume that, okay, Google Classroom will take care. No. Unless we are updating our materials, unless we are engaging our learners, no learning can happen. That is why, please underline the sentence, the teacher is the most important factor for any learning to take place. So let me go to an overview of the emergence of the online teacher. Like Renu also pointed out in the introduction, necessity is the mother of invention. Knowingly or unknowingly, we are all undergoing a pedagogical shift. That is a paradigm shift in the way teachers are dealing with learners, in the way learners are learning themselves. Earlier, we used to force a lot of restrictions when our children are using the mobile phone. But these days, we are thinking whether we should give them a separate device, because we are also using it for conducting classes. And when my son or my daughter is asking for a mobile phone, I'm thinking maybe it will be useful for the academic purposes. So there is the necessity now. You know, they say necessity is the mother of invention. So now there is a need for all the teachers, online teachers also. So there are some current requirements and pedagogical shifts. Many schools are going online. People are trying to experiment with a lot of tools that are available. That is why I've put here the current requirements and pedagogical shifts have also emerged. All of us know that the web 1.0, which was the previous, you know, before smartphones came, all of us were using the web 1.0 version. It was a content-centric paradigm. What do I mean by content-centric paradigm? If you want to know about anything, you will type it in Google and the content would come up. We were majorly consumers of information. We will go to the internet to refer to something. I still remember during my PhD days in 2006 to 2009, I will go to an internet cafe with a floppy disk. So the floppy disk, you know, these days our children talk about 1 TB of data, 1 GB of data. The pen drive that they want should be 64 GB. But the floppy disk that we used to carry, you know, 244 MB or 250 MB, we used to carry that particular floppy disk. And we used to go to these internet centers. We were consumers of information. But now in the web 2.0 paradigm, it is a social centric paradigm. All of us are contributing, where we are using a lot of social media and a vast array of participatory applications and tools. Now, WhatsApp, everyone is using for academic purposes also. It's very easy to check whether learners have seen our instructions. So all teachers have a WhatsApp group where the students are also participating. So we have so many tools and other applications which we are using. Now this has become social centric. What I mean is all of us are contributing. We are no longer consumers of information, but we are also creators of lot of data. We are uploading so much of data. So that basic understanding we will have before we proceed. And definitely all these things have theoretical underpinnings also. When I'm talking about interacting in a social media, interacting in a social sphere on a virtual platform, this is based on Vygotsky's sociocultural theory, where he talks about every learner participating and socially constructing meaning. And then it is also based on activity theory. So activity theory in the classroom operates a little differently, but on the online platform where the child is asked to go and refer to certain websites, take information, convert it into his or her own writing, all these are also activities. When the child is attending a quiz on Google Forms, these are also some activities. The next one is situated learning theory. Of course, Lev and Wenger talks about it, but remember, whatever theories we have, it should be pedagogy-driven technology. Technology cannot be used for its own sake. There should be a very strong pedagogical underpinning for any kind of technology that we are using. What I mean is, we have to decide that we are going to teach this particular aspect today in the class, in the online class, and we should focus more on that. So, always remember, the more engaged your audience is, the more they will take away from your presentation. So I want all of you to be very engaged now. So I'm going to ask you all to try and use the chat box. What I want you to do is, I want you to type in the chat box, what are some of the ways that you use to make your classroom very lively? I mean the online classroom. So if you have any tips or tools that you're already using, please feel free. And please enter it in the chat box. I'm just going to view the chat box now. I'll give you 30 seconds for this. And let us see how many answers we are going to get. You play a quiz. You ask a lot of discussion. Okay, asking questions, questionnaire, videos, stories. Selvi, Fernando, Premjit, all of you have answered. Quiz, discussion, breakout rooms, peer teaching, language games. Okay, so a lot of answers are coming. It's very interesting to see all these answers also. Thank you for, chatting online, e-class, video sharing, preparing your PPT and YouTube videos, Jinsi Tom. That's very interesting. So sharing images, use chart and pictures, Google Meet for live discussion. Very good. Children's opinion on a topic. Shagufa Patel says, children's opinion is also essential. Interesting. So thank you for being such nice interactive students. Puppet videos, you're using icebreakers. Yes. So you're a very informed audience.
Continue.
Padlet and Wakelet. Zoom application purchased by the school. My own video. That is interesting. Ipti Joshi says she uses her own video. Sharing the worksheets, storytelling. Thank you. Thank you for being such an interactive audience. Let us move on with the presentation now. So now I have a clear background. I have elicited responses. So before I start teaching something to my audience, I usually do this kind of polling. I usually do this kind of eliciting. So I'm trying to understand the level of my audience. So usually when we enter a learner's classroom, it's absolutely important to understand the learner's level. Now, say for example, I don't do this activity and I don't understand what is the level of my audience. I can keep, explaining very basic things, but you might have already known that. I could have given you a lot of advanced tools also. So it is very important to do this kind of an interactive, quick you know, a game or a questioning, so that the audience also feel kind of validated. That is very important. So Tanvir, Nazar, the background, Google tests, quiz, picture puzzles. Yeah, students love picture puzzles. I'm sure that they must be very interesting in the classroom. Thank you so much. Yeah. So now we are moving on to the second section, which is engaging content design and delivery. So look at this picture. You can see how the child, you know, is trying to sit before a computer and learn. There is so much of confusion because the child has used the computer for various purposes, but never for educating. Never for education or, you know, for video conferencing online. So we have to understand what kinds of problems can come. I can see that the chat box is very active, singing together. Tesmos test is also helpful. Now, what we are actually doing is we have created that social constructivist model of Vygotsky. Because the moment you're all typing in your answers, see this platform not, you know, one where I am giving you all the knowledge, but we are co-creators of knowledge. When you're giving all these answers, many other participants will be wondering, oh, I have not tried this more. Maybe I should try this. So they will also be trying. That is why it is important to use the chat box very effectively. So very interesting answers are coming in. So when it comes to content, the content has to be relevant, first of all. Now, sometimes in our enthusiasm to find out very interesting content, we try and digress from the topic. We put too much on the online classroom, whether it is the PPT that we are preparing, you know, whether it is the content. So it has to be highly relevant. The next thing is it has to be limited. By limited, what do I mean? You know the attention span of students. So in a limited attention span of students, how are you going to deliver to them what matters to them most? So it has to be limited in a 40 minutes time or in a 45 minutes period. The third thing is multimodal. Now, all of you have given so many clues. You have said vocab test, picture puzzles, presentation. What you're trying to do is you're trying to bring a lot of multimedia videos. You know, sometimes when you make these videos where you're delivering the content, self videos, the teachers, the students find it very interesting. You know, they want to see how you're speaking. They want to see, listen to our voice. That is why more than sharing TED Talks or other kinds of ideas, I simplify it and I post it to my students. I record myself and I post it to my students. And the next one is it should be in chunks. What do I mean when I say it should be in chunks? Now, say for example, if you want to teach prepositions, don't give them a big list of prepositions with examples and sentences. You can try and break it into prepositions of time, prepositions of place. So give it in small chunks. So after every section, you can try and give a test or you can give a kind of an activity. So it has to go in chunks. And then the content should be highly structured. What do I mean? That, you know, it should be structured in the sense from simple. You should start from the known and then you go to the unknown, from simple to the complex. So it has to be highly structured. And then there should be a lot of encouraging for self-learning. Give them a lot of materials. You know, when you're doing multiple, there will be a chance to give a lot of materials. So that way also we can try and encourage different kinds of content diversity you can do. When it comes to the design, depends on the age of your learners. If you're going to do something for school children, primary school children, then it will be very different. If you're going to, you know, do it for a high school learner, then the design will be very different. Now look at this design. This is an abstract concept. You can see some dots, some colors, and the text has been highlighted. There is a rule where they say that 7 lines is the maximum of bullet points you can use, maximum of 7 words. That is the 7 into 7 rule when you're designing something. You can see how there are only 5 lines and 3 words in each. So sometimes in our you know, enthusiasm to give more information, we can do it, but we should think about the level of the audience. If the audience is really young, keep it very simple like this. Include a lot of pictures. But of course, I'm talking to a very mature audience now. I'm talking to teachers. So some of my slides will have lots of material. Yes, Nadia wants to know, you mean various materials. Yes, I mean various materials which we can use. It has to be simple and elegant videos. Now, when it comes to elegant videos, all of us love to do videos and share. Now in the lockdown period, we have so much time in our hands also. So when you're doing a video, there are so many things we have to, keep in our mind. Now say, for example, I am speaking to you from one part of my room, right? So you know that usually our houses with children all day along in the house, you know how it is. So we have to find a nice corner and we have to make it our Zoom spot. So this is my Zoom spot. You can see how that, you know, I have kept some minimum materials in the background, because some of them, they like it to keep all their, you know, things that they have. It is up to you to create very elegant videos. The lighting that you have, your internet connection, all these things will be contributing. For high school, do you think PPT should be animated? I don't think it should be highly animated, but the level, you know, how much of animation you're going to use. And say, for example, if you're going to teach them the function of the heart, so how the heart beats, if you want to show that kind of an animation, you can show. So it has to be relevant to the content. What do I mean by interface choice? Now say, for example, you want to use Google Meet or you want to use Zoom. So all those interface choice should also be suitable to the learner context. Now delivery. The delivery of the content should be planned ahead. Planned ahead in the sense, prepare your PPTs. Check the spellings, check everything on the PPT. Now say, for example, if now I want to share a video, I should stop sharing. I should quickly go to the video, which means I should have opened it in the desktop already. If I have not opened and kept it in the desktop already, then I will be searching for it in my desktop. At the same time, you will be looking at all the other folders on my desktop, all the other files, and you will be wondering what is inside that file. And you know how curious our students are. So they will also try and do the same thing. So everything should be planned ahead and integrate the flipped model. What do I mean by the flipped model? Give them all the materials beforehand. Now say, for example, if there is some kind of a learning material, give it to them beforehand, ask them to read, come to the online class. So that in the online class, they can ask the questions, you can clarify the doubts, you can do the activities instead of asking them to go through all the materials. So if some of my, you know, in my son's class, some teachers begin with a prayer. So every day one student has to say the prayer. They never know who will be asked. So all the students will be present. And when the teacher calls out for a particular name, that student will be unmuting and saying the prayer. So that gives involvement, right? The students are, you know, they are, it gives a lot of involvement. And one student has to give the three top news. All these things you can try and do. So this is called the flipped model and delivery diversity. Now, because we are all adult learners, you are able to listen to me very quietly, right? I am speaking in a monotonous voice and I'm giving you a lecture using a PPT, but you are able to tolerate it. But think of our school students. You can use puppets to show, you can put a mask one day. Okay, so you can do that kind of a delivery diversity. You can show them a song, you can show them a video. Some teachers have sent, you know, the physical education teacher has sent some exercises also. Now we know that learning yoga online, all these working out online has all come. So delivery diversity is very important. Please keep that also in mind. But first of all, if you see, it is very important to undergo some kind of training. Train instructors in online learning. Now, what Renu has done is excellent, because Renu has tried to bring in people who can talk about these kinds of ideas. So a lot of training is required. And then even students also should be given some kind of training, some kind of orientation. You can post some kind of, videos where you are explaining how to do it. You can use some open source software to explain. You can open your screen and you can say, first you have to click this button for download, then this will come, then you will have to store it in the applications. So you can try and do that. this is how you nurture intrinsic motivation. Because the student gets a sense of ownership and control. The student feels like, okay, now I am responsible for my learning. I will take ownership. And then regularly update course content. I know it is very difficult when it comes to online teaching, because when it comes to face-to-face teaching, we have all our Xerox copies, our notebooks ready. But when it comes to online, you have to type everything. You have to create your videos. All these things are very important. Encourage accountability. If some student does an initiative, takes an initiative and explains, we have to appreciate that child. So when some of us are doing that now, say for example, you have a WhatsApp group and you are giving some kind of an instruction to the children, the student who is posting it first, now we have to encourage that child. We have to put in some good feedback so that the child will be feeling motivated, and you know, seeing that child, so many others will come. So that is also called as modeling. So when you're modeling one child, you know, the positive behavior, all of us know about positive behavior and reinforcement. So we have to encourage all that in our online teaching also. So further, some more elements I have given for the activities to keep it very engaging in the classroom, how you can break down the lesson, how you can adapt in-class activities to the virtual classroom. Now, say for example, Simon Says, that is a very good activity you can try in online also. You can ask all your students to, you know, let them sit. You can give some instructions for them. Okay, all of us are going to do Simon Says activity. Of course, it's very challenging with all the network issues and everything, but that is something we can try. And make your students feel valued. If some student is not coming, you'll have to ask. Now, say for example, when I read some of your names, with lot of exam, when I tell your names and when I say you have given this answer, there is so much of pleasure that we derive. You know, they say the sweetest name of earth on earth is our own name. So when I say somebody's name, they feel very good. They feel very validated. That is why it is important for teachers to know all the names in the class and also tell the names of the children. Even in online platform, you have to address your children by names, and you can read out the names that will feel them very valued. Set goals and have students stick to the goals. So a weekly plan. Tell them that these are the topics that we will be covering in this week, and you'll have to stick to the plan. And look at the fifth point, the most important point. Present your best online self. Now, students have seen us in classrooms. We are wearing very formal clothes. We are very strict and all that. But when it comes to online, our children are also very curious to look at our homes. They want to see who is walking in between, right? These kind of things should not distract them from focusing into the classroom. So you have to present your best online self. No shouting, no yelling. All these things should be avoided. Bring fun into the classroom. This is something, you know, I always emphasize on. Many teachers, they say, you know, they are very comfortable teaching face-to-face. But once they come on the online platform, somehow, you know, they become very strict. Now, that can come from our problems and challenges with the technology. Now, say, for example, my network is not okay or my voice is not audible. Then I become very tensed, right? Then I am like looking at the screen like this. I am trying and fidgeting with the keyboard. I am trying to call people and find out. So all this can create a sense of distancing. So even on your when you're on the online screen, you have to smile. You have to address your children. You have to look at the camera and speak. So these are all some engagement strategies. All of you know very well about the power of eye contact, right? Of course, now I cannot see any of you. But then when I'm looking on the camera, I know that some of us are, you know, in contact. You're looking at me. Yes, Tanveer Nazar says gestures are very important. Of course, gestures are also very important. Now, be patient with your students. Some of the students might have problems operating with technology. Just like we have dyslexic learners, we try and tolerate them in the classes. We try and help them a lot. Even in technology, some of our best students might not have the gadgets. Sometimes, you know, they might not have the data network. We have to be patient with them. If a student is not submitting on time, we have to try and explain, find out the problem, first of all. So when you're trying and doing all these things, then I think the student will also be interested and the student will become very engaging. So move on to the interactive tools, techniques, and strategies. So long we focused on the content, the design, and the delivery styles in order to make it engaging. So now you also have to look at what are the tools, techniques, and strategies that you can adopt. Like you said, using questions and answers. Yes, Nandini ma'am, we have to use eye contact, gestures, and smile. That is very important for teachers. So when you're using question and answers, ask simple questions and give sample answers. Now say for example, as English teachers, we can use the chat box as a great tool to exploit writing activities. Now, say for example, you want to ask them, now students are joining the group and you know there is 5 more minutes for the session to start. You can simply type in an answer saying, what did you do in the weekend? I went shopping, or you know, I slept for 4 hours continuously. You can type something so that the children will see that structure and they will try to emulate. So they will try and see, okay, we can also type our answer like this. So a lot of sentence frames they will understand. Ask learners to create their own answers using frames. Probably you can give a sentence and you can put a dash in between, which children can try and frame in. All these are subconscious learning methods. They assimilate very well. You know that as teachers, we are digital immigrants, but our students are digital natives. So when you're using technology, it comes very automatically to them. And you can also focus implicitly on the subject of the day. Now, say, for example, I am planning to teach adjectives today to my learners. So I can, you know, as soon as I start my session in the chat box, I can say, I think it's a fantastic day today. What do you think? Now, some of us can start typing their answers. They can use a lot of adjectives. They can say, you know, how it's a boring day. It's a busy day. So they can use a lot of adjectives. Then you can try and answer them. So what you can do is you can focus implicitly. Indirectly, you can say how they spoke about their days, how they spoke about the adjectives, and then we can slowly lead them to the topic of the day. So we are using live chat now. You can also try it. It is very interactive. And it gives a sense of ownership for the participants also, similarly your learners. Encourage learners to exchange short, snappy messages. What do I mean by snappy messages? Quick messages, you know, it should not be a long message, but then it should be a very short and snappy message. Improves questioning techniques. When you are trying to do live chat, it will also improve questioning techniques, because so many of you are asking questions to me now. Some of you are saying, you know, suggest ways of teaching process for high school students. I can see those questions. So when you are looking at all these questions, it will also help them to type in question, and it will increase their questioning techniques. Now, all of you know that in the 21st century skills, critical thinking skills are very important. And how does critical thinking skill improve? Through questioning. Usually teachers are very comfortable asking the questions. We don't want to answer. But then using the live chat will also enhance their questioning skills. Observers can learn from others' chats. All classrooms have extroverts and introverts, right? Just because I'm coming online, it doesn't mean that I'm going to speak a lot. If I'm an introvert in my classroom, even in my online class, I would sit and I would observe what others are doing. Though I don't want to participate in a discussion, I will be reading what is being written. So don't worry that one learner is not responding, that one learner is absorbing everything when it is done in the chat box. So you have to use the live chat option. The next one is polls. Now, polls, if you see, there are a lot of open source tools. Now, that would be an entirely different session if I want to tell you about the open source tools that are available. So you have to try and tell them, you have to integrate some kind of a polling option. Now, these days, if you see in mobile phones, Mentimeter, I will show you in the next slide, how we can create a lot of tools where children can give their answers through polls also. So this will attendees' opinions can be gathered and everyone can contribute. As I told you, it inculcates a sense of belonging. And you can also take useful feedback through specific questions. So these are all some ways for us to make our webinars, to make our online classes very interesting. Visual content. Now, this is extremely important because if you see even my own slide, you can see that there are some meaningless shapes, right? Some content. And human beings are all visually wired. We mostly remember what we see in pictures. Our human brain is wired that way. So it is important to engage learners through visuals. And then you can also tell them, show a picture, and you can tell them to transcribe the visual. You know, change this visual into verbal. Put it in the chat box. So interesting pictures can lead to very interesting discussions. So it depends upon our talent as a teacher, how to select very interesting visual content. Multimedia also, like I told you, you have to prepare well ahead. Use the whiteboard relevantly. Now, Zoom also has this whiteboard. You must be using a whiteboard, you know, when you're using. I have seen many teachers, they keep their camera, they use a whiteboard and they start writing on it. Of course, we also have lots of challenges. There are many teachers above 50 and, you know, above who are also trying to explore the online platform. So kudos to all to those teachers. And then you have to change the media to retain the attention span. So multimedia and tools definitely play a very important role. But annotations are a big problem. Nadeem Kanji, you know, it is very easy because in the Zoom, when you are starting, there is an option to disable participant annotation. So if you are going to disable the annotation by the participants, you cannot touch my PowerPoint. If you want, you can try. You can try and annotate this PowerPoint. It will say that, you know, the speaker has disabled annotations on the PowerPoint. Okay. And then change media to retain attention span. Of course, we spoke about all these things. Instant quizzes. Now, most of us might be wondering, okay, how do I conduct a quiz online? But then there is this app called Quizzes. There is also a website for it. What you can do is, and the best thing about quizzes is, you don't have to type the questions. You don't have to prepare the questions also. They have a big question bank depending on the subjects you want. Now, say, for example, like I told you, I want to create a quiz based on adverbs, or I want to create a quiz based on, say, Rabindranath Tagore. So all I can do is, if I simply type the keyword, I will get the quizzes which have been already created by so many teachers, and I can pick the questions. Isn't that very interesting? So I don't have to spend a lot of time typing the questions, MCQs, everything. All I have to do is simply cut and paste, simply choose one question. So I can prepare a nice question bank of 10 or 15 questions. And then it is live quiz also. It's an online quiz. So there are a lot of YouTube videos explaining the quizzes. It's a very useful tool that I use, especially in webinars. And then this Mentimeter. Mentimeter can be integrated into PowerPoint presentations, and you can also conduct quizzes on Mentimeter. There are so many tools, but believe me, these two have been extremely useful for me. Okay, we have come to the last section of the presentation. What are the takeaways? Now, the takeaway when it comes, whether you are a teacher or a learner, from that particular online session that you're doing, you'll have to think about what is the learner, you know, taking away from your particular session. Now, say, for example, you have certain ideas to say, but then the learner is not able to comprehend it. How do you actually say that? I have two important things to tell you. As teachers, you know, whether we are in Maharashtra or in Tamil Nadu, it is extremely important that we engage in continuous professional development. Like Renu pointed out rightly, all these are CPD activities, right? Okay, Nadia wants to know what's Mentimeter. Mentimeter is a polling kind of a function. You will get a code once you log in and once you create the question. And then using the code, our students can give their lot of, you know, opinion, information they can give. And that will also be reflected on the screen. It's very fun. There are a lot of YouTube videos that we can watch on how to use Mentimeter. Now, there are many online courses. Teachers, we must know that these online courses are free for people who do not want a certificate. You can simply say, I want to audit this course. There is that option. Or a certificate, or do you want to simply audit the course? Audit the course means you are seeing all the materials of the course. You can simply enroll in it. And now, because of the COVID crisis, most of the universities are trying and giving these kind of courses for free. So one course that I found extremely useful is Coursera's Learning to Teach Online course. And then you also have the Arizona State University's course, you know, for teachers, for teaching online, which is extremely useful. You can try and engage in these courses, enroll in these courses, and learn a lot, because teachers are lifelong learners. This is the final thing I want to tell you. Teacher motivation also increases with student engagement and participation. So don't think that just because the student is engaged, only the student is benefiting. Teachers are also going to be benefited. There are definitely other kinds of things like time management, because when it comes to online courses, you have to plan. You have to try and say, for example, I will speak only for 40 minutes. So I will speak only for 40 to 45 minutes. I should not go beyond that. Then the student will lose credibility on our part. And if we say that is the deadline to stop receiving assignments, we should stop receiving assignments. So these are all certain ideas that have come from my side for you to keep your classes engaging and interactive. Thank you. That would be the end of the presentation. Now I am moving on to the chat box. I am seeing all the questions. How many tests or quiz can we take in a week for students? Anubala Kataria wants to know. That depends on the kind of content that you are giving. Say, for example, if the content is, if it is history, of course, we are all English teachers. If it is about, reading a lesson and submitting assignments, I would say that 1 week you can have MCQs, short answers, and give them an assignment for a long-term basis also. So you can try and understand, what are the student needs, how to try and plan your sessions. You can try and do that, okay? Can we use Kahoot? Yes, you can use Kahoot, but always remember, Kahoot works very well in classroom, right? When you are showing the questions on the screen and when students have to put A, B, C, or D, it is very interactive. I'm looking for some more questions here. How to motivate introvert students? Okay, Alifia wants to know. Like I told you, in our face-to-face classes, what do? In order to motivate introvert students, we put them in groups. You know, sometimes we don't want to pressurize them by making them stand up in the class and speak. But then if you're putting them in a peer group, when you're putting them in the peer group, they are ready to contribute, so their comfort zones. As teachers, I think understanding learner behavior and learner psychology is very important, because when you're dealing with young learners, it's a totally different ballgame altogether. Now, say for example, all of us know the multiple intelligences theory. Some of us are visual learners. Some of us are auditory learners, right? Some of us are kinesthetic learners. We want to touch and see. We are very tactile. Okay, they want to touch and see and experience. Usually they say introverted learners are mostly tactile learners. They want to touch and feel and find out. So maybe when you're creating group activities, when you're creating TLMs, you can try and keep in mind how the introvert will answer. Because you have seen very well how after a few years of time, introverts become very good speakers and teachers. My own teacher used to tell me, you would never speak in the class, but now you're a teacher. I can't believe this. So all of us undergo that phase. Maybe in your class, he's an introvert. In another class, he or she will be very active. So don't worry too much, but keep in mind that all your materials should address a very heterogeneous group. That is very important. Can I try and see if there are some more questions? A lot of thank yous are coming in. What about LD children? How effective is this virtual lesson for him? Now, virtual lessons, if you see, have come to us not by choice. We did not choose to become online teachers, right? we became online teachers overnight because of COVID. So Beulah ma'am, that question was Arjuman Said, sir. Okay. So when you're talking about, you know, children, whether it is lower proficiency or when they are having some other challenges, we will have to think about the variety, the delivery diversity, the ease of presentation. Now in online, you can prepare so many materials, give them a lot of links to, you know, different kinds of materials which they can try and plan. So some of us also have the fear of, you know, what to do when I prepare everything and do screen sharing, audio and video is not working. Yes, that is also possible sometimes because of network and everything. But now fairly, I think we are all comfortable with the virtual platform and how we are able to, you know, work with it. So that is also a question that we should think about. I won't say that every time it will be very good. You don't have to worry. But then that is also a concern. We are living in India. The maximum bandwidth we get is very limited. So Renu, that would be end of my session. Do you have any question for me?
Yeah, there is one question from Facebook. How to encourage teenage learners?
Mm-hmm. Okay. Online classes. Very interesting question. Okay. I have a teenage son myself. And, you know, I used to have a lot of discussions with him about his online classes. He's in 10th grade. So when I'm talking to my teenage son, he would tell me like, you know, they are very competitive, right? At that age, they are highly competitive. They like games. When their teacher is talking about, you know, some video game character, or in the PPT, suddenly there's a video game character. The video game character is trying to explain mathematics or something. They become very interested. They love gamification. So there is this idea of gamification, a very trending topic when it comes to online learning. So you can explore further on how to gamify your teaching. So that would be, you know, one way to find out. Yes, Nadeem ji.
Yeah, one more question from Rohini on Facebook. What will you suggest for lower grades?
Lower grades. Okay. So lower grades children, I think when it comes to them, we will have to plan a lot of kinesthetic activities where, you know, say, for example, I'm going to teach you about the shapes, then I can actually bring the shapes and I can show and I can tell them to bring one shape tomorrow. So they can try and bring it and they can explain it. A lot of songs can be inculcated, you know, some dance movements. So primary learners, if you see, they are very interested in doing these things. So maybe you can try, you know, those methods also.
Yeah, thank you, Shobha ma'am. And over to you, Renu ma'am.
Thank you, Shobha, so much. It was just a call and you agreed to give a session, and the session really was very informative. I thank you on behalf of all the participants, and I thank you on behalf of Mnet that it was something that was required at this pandemic time. Thank you. I request Dominic, sir.
Yes.
You're most welcome.
Mm-hmm. Hello, ma'am.
Yes.
Ma'am, if it is possible, then all the teachers can put their presentation if in this group, CHESS ETF group. So many ideas teachers can understand that how to teach the students on this presentation.
Yes. Okay, ma'am, you want the presentation, the PowerPoint slide? Are you talking about?
It may suppose, sir, agar koi bhi teachers presentation karte hain, to agar apna CHESS ETF mein agar dalte hain, to sabhi teachers ko bhi bahut sare ideas milenge ke kis tarah se hame kar sakte hain aisa.
Okay. Renu ma'am has taken a note and she will do it. Thank you.
Yeah, I'll work on it.
Yeah, thank you, ma'am. Thank you so much.
Yeah, definitely, Deepti. You know, I will share my PDF.
Over to you, Dominic, sir.
Yeah. Good evening, everyone.
Good evening, sir.
It was a real pleasure to listen to Dr. Shobha. You must not have seen the comments on the Facebook. They were fantastic.
Okay.
And one of the comments that I would like to say here is, it was a meticulously planned presentation. From someone from the Facebook. Okay.
Dominic sir, can I please interrupt?
Yes, sure.
Because I always believe that failing to plan is planning to fail. So everything we should plan meticulously. If you want to fail, you can stop planning. So failing to plan is planning to fail.
So that can one more takeaway from today's webinar. You went toward very systematically with the content, design, delivery, and all those things. It was very well done. There are many takeaways which you have already given at the end of your session. Just a few things to remember. For example, one was present your best online self. It was very, very interesting. Yeah. But the teachers should realize that. And your Zoom corner was a very nice idea. Having a Zoom corner in your room.
Zoom spot.
Yeah, Zoom spot. I'm going to do it tomorrow onwards. I'm sure all of us are going to do that. And another point was about the importance of subconscious learning methods. Making students learn without knowing that they're learning. These are very, very beautiful things that you've spoken about. Because there are so many other things. And the last thing I would say is, that is, after the presentation, after the lecture, the teacher gets more motivated than anyone else.
I'm sure
you are more motivated than anyone else today.
Yes.
Wonderful one. Best of to you for the great thing.
Okay. Thank you so much for your kind words. You have observed my presentation very carefully.
Because I have to. Yes.
Thank you, ma'am.
So once again, thanks on behalf of the MDET and on behalf of all the participants from different parts of India and even the different parts of the world, I should say. There are some foreign participants also. And thank you, Renu, for getting Dr. Shukma for us. A big clap to you.
Thank you, Renu, for having me. Thank you, you know, all
thank you, Shukma Network. Coming.
Yeah. And of course, Nadeem sir and his INET Connect for making you live to all of us. You were just really talking to us. It was wonderful. And of course,
live and lively.
Yeah, of course, the participants need a big, big thanks there. All of them are very, very effectively participating from beginning till end. A lot of interactions with them. So thanks, everyone from INET side. Thanks again.
Thanks, Dr. Shobha from MDET.
Participant, there's one instruction that I want you all to follow. Please put your email ID properly. Because I have got a lot of emails regarding not receiving the certificates. What I have done, it's auto-generated certificate. So if your email address is wrong, you will not receive the certificate. And the certificate comes back to me. So please, when you're filling the feedback form, fill your email address properly. And do not put Miss or Mrs. before your name, because it is already put in one of the sections in Google Form.
Yeah.
Please take a note of it. And thank you to participate. And I assure you that in the next series also, you will enjoy the speaker, and she is working out with vocabulary and vocabulary in various aspects. Multilingualism, traditional way. So be tuned and do attend the next series.
Next Wednesday.
Woman.
Yeah.
Okay. All the best. Thank all you. The best to all the Mumbai Network teachers.
Thank you, Shobha.
Thank you. That's all for the day. Thank you very much for joining us.
Thank you.